Give him all the glory and honor. Praise God this morning. You're worthy of all the praise. You're worthy, yes you are. Oh, you are, and I will not be. Declare it this morning.
morning, everyone. I'm Elder Robert Jackson. I want to welcome you to our service this morning. May God bless you.
Welcome to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. You are viewing the worship services of the Berean Seventh-day Adventist Church in Jackson, Mississippi, where we are joining God's people to his kingdom. And we want to extend everyone a great big welcome. Welcome to the house of God. The house of God is not a place. The house of God are the people of God gathered with the Lord himself for worship. And so we want to say thank you. As always, we want to issue a great big welcome to all of our guests. If you are with us for the first time or the second time, we welcome you. Check in with us, 601-258-4040, and let us know that you are in the house. Amen, amen, amen. We want to thank all of those who contribute to our worship service every week with your stories, with your contribution, your prayers, all of those things. It really lightens the load, but it also really makes the worship service more participatory. So we're going to ask that you just continue to send those in. If you have problems uploading, just kind of let us know, give us a call, and we will make sure that we get your information so that you can be a part of our worship. Amen, 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 amen. We also want to just continue to invite you to all of the worship services that we have every Sabbath morning at 9:45. We gather together for worship. That is an interactive service. So we meet on Zoom exclusively for our Sabbath school, again, 9:45. We also meet there for our Wednesday night prayer service. That is exclusively on Zoom as well. And here is the number. The ID code is there. Most of you should already have the password. If not, just send us an email so that we can send that out to you. Again, we just welcome all of you to be a part of our worship services. Amen, amen. On behalf of my family, on behalf of the leadership team of the Berean Church, again, we welcome you to worship today. We pray that God extend a rich blessing to you as we worship together. God bless you.
Marvelous things, praise the Lord. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
When building a friendship, remember to be supportive. Two people are better off than one, for they can help each other succeed. If one person falls, the other person can reach out and help. But someone who falls alone is in real trouble. Likewise, two people lying close together can keep each other warm.
But how can one be warm alone? A person standing alone can be attacked and defeated, but two can stand back to back and conquer. They are even better. For a triple bonded cord is not easily broken.
Ecclesiastes 4:9-12.
Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
Let us go to God in prayer. Father, Lord, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for this day. Lord, we thank you for all that you're doing for each one of us, Lord. Lord, even though we're separate, Father, Lord, we're close to you. And so, Father, Lord, continue to cover us, Father, Lord, as we continue to lift you up, magnify you. But, Lord, you're worthy to be praised, Lord, in this time where it looks like it's just doom and gloom. But, Father, Lord, you are the sun. You are the brightness. And, Lord, you come to us, Father, Lord, just like we are like deers panting, Father, Lord, for water. Lord, we love you. Lord, we're asking right now, Lord, that you could just continue to protect each one of us, Lord. Lord, as we go out and come in, Lord, bless us, Father, Lord. Lord, we're asking right now that you be with the members of Berean, Father, Lord, where we meet us where we are, Father, Lord, with every need, Father, Lord. Not our will, but let thy will be done. Lord, we're asking right now, Lord, during this time of looks like despair, Father, Lord, continue to just show up strong in our lives. Lord, you said where we're weak, you are strong. So, Father, Lord, we're asking right now, Lord, that you strengthen us right now. Lord, we're asking that you bless those that are in the hospitals, Father, Lord, who may be even dealing with the COVID-19, Father, Lord. Lord, we're asking that you bless them, Father, Lord, and bring them through according to your will and purpose so that they'll have a testimony of how good you are. Father, Lord, we're asking, Lord, right now that you be with those who may have a financial need, Father, Lord. Bless right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, even those who are homeless, Father, Lord, we're asking that you cover them, Father, Lord, and protect them. Lord, we're asking that you be with the doctors. And Lord, we ask that you be with those who are about to go to school, Father, Lord. Be with the teachers, Father, Lord. Even prepare them now. Touch their immune system. Strengthen them right now, Father, Lord. Be with the students, Father, Lord. Let them come with an expectancy of learning, Father, Lord. And then when it's all said and done, Father, Lord, you get the glory out of this. Be with the leaders of our country, the leaders of our state, the leaders of our local government. Father, Lord, we're praying right now for our pastor. Touch him. Take him into the depths of the sea of knowledge, Father, Lord, so that he'll bring back nuggets of truth that he may share with us, Father, Lord, so that we won't sin against thee. Lord, we love you and we say thank you in the name of Jesus. We do pray. Amen.
Hey, good morning again. We want to, this is our giving time, the time when we reflect on our giving. So we thank you again, once again, for your contributions to our tithes, to our offerings. We thank you for the support of the ministry of the Berean Seventh-day Adventist Church. Like we told you before, our building may be shut down, but ministry is not shut down. We are very active in our community, active with our youth. The work of God is continuing to move forward. But for that to happen, we need your gifts. So we want to continue to ask that you be faithful and bring your tithe and offering. Again, for those who mail them in, the address is here. And for others, the Adventist Giving Online is the way that you can easily, very easily give those, return those tithes and offering every week. We also have our weekly drop-off times when we are here to receive those tithes and offering. Amen. So whichever way you give, it doesn't matter. Just make sure that you give. And right now, we just want to have a word of prayer over our offerings and over of that which God has blessed us with. Heavenly Father, God, we are appreciative and thankful that you have been faithful to us, God. We know that there are a lot who are struggling, a lot who are trying to figure out how to make it, God. And yet, Lord God, one way or another, Lord God, you continue to bring your people through. God, we thank you for their faithfulness and their giving, God. May you continue to bless us, Lord God, and may we continue to be faithful to you. We ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Don't consider it singing. It's just family worship. Is that all right?
My life was torn beyond repair. I felt so alone. Felt no one cared. But you came along and gave me a song to ease the pain and erase the strain. You could have
been standing there.
No one.
I'm
Amen, amen, amen. We want to thank you again for being with us in worship. Did you enjoy that beautiful song? Amen. It is our preaching time when we go to the Word of God. Let's pray together before we go into the Word. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for allowing us into your presence once again. Lord, as we open up the Word of God, I ask that you would open up our hearts that we may see your love and your power and all that you do in our behalf, especially during challenging times. Bless us, God, in the name of Jesus. Amen. If you have your Bibles, our text today is coming from the book of 2 Kings. 2 Kings, the 18th chapter, is where we're going to begin. Mine is going to read just a little bit different than yours because I'm reading from the New Living Translation. But grab your Bibles and join with me as we read the Word of God together. It provides a foundation for our message on today. Here's what the Word of God says. 2 Kings, the 18th chapter, beginning at verse number 11. It says, "And at that time, the king of Assyria exiled the Israelites to Assyria and placed them in colonies and Halah along the banks of the harbor river Gozan and in the cities of the Medes, for they refused to listen to the Lord their God and obey him. Instead, they violated his covenant, all the laws that Moses, the Lord's servant, had commanded them to obey." Verse number 13. "And in the 14th year of Hezekiah's reign, King Sennacherib of Assyria came to attack the fortified towns of Judah and conquered them. King Hezekiah sent this message to the king of Assyria at Lachish: 'I have done wrong. I will pay whatever tribute money you demand if you will only withdraw.' King of Assyria then demanded a settlement more than 11 tons of silver and 1 ton of gold. To gather this amount, King Hezekiah used all of the silver stored in the temple of the Lord and in the palace treasury. Hezekiah even stripped the gold from the doors of the Lord's temple and from the doorposts he had overlaid with gold, and he gave it all to the Assyrian king." Our message for today is entitled "The Disrespect of the Enemy." The disrespect of the enemy. This is a very sad text that talks about when the people of God found themselves in a predicament. Syrian king Sennacherib was on a conquest. He had already conquered Israel. Israel fell to him, and the Bible says that they were taken to Assyria. And the text says that not only did he attack the cities of Judah, the text says that he attacked the fortified cities of Judah. He attacked them, and the text says that he had conquered them. When Hezekiah sends him message, he had already taken the city of Lachish. It was a very difficult time, and you've got to understand this besiegement, that it was very cruel and folk were suffering. And you can tell a little bit about that by what happened and his response to it. For he was now beginning to march on Jerusalem, just about to take Jerusalem. And Hezekiah says, "Look, Doc, man, I'll do whatever you want me to do. I'll pay whatever you want me to pay. Just don't do us like you've done the rest of Judah, the disrespect of the enemy. This scenario reminds me of something, and I want to share it with you. There are a lot of us who, in good times, we talk about what we won't do and what we will never do. But this text reminds me of something, and that is that don't ever say what you won't do. Huh? Don't ever say what you won't do. I would imagine that King Hezekiah never imagined that he would be in a position to take all of the money out of his treasury, huh? Empty his bank accounts and give it to a foreign heathen king. I would imagine that Hezekiah never imagined that he would ever be in a situation where he would be taking all of the money out of the church to give it to the enemy of God. And it got so bad that the text says that Hezekiah was stripping the gold off the doorpost of the temple. And I know you guys are looking at Hezekiah and you say, man, what a trifling, what a terrible individual. But the reality is Hezekiah found himself in a difficult, yea, deadly situation, a desperate situation. And sometimes desperate times make folk do desperate things. Chiseling the gold off the doorpost to give it to the enemy. Because of what he had seen Sennacherib do to all of the other kingdoms. And then he finally saw Sennacherib begin to do it to him. Y'all, you know, we can say a whole bunch of stuff, but don't ever say what you won't do. The other thing, though, that we see as we approach the narrative for today, huh? I want to suggest this, and that is that we give the enemy too much credit. We give the enemy too much credit. What do you mean? In this scenario, we saw Sennacherib take down Israel and take down all of the other kingdoms. And so based on that, we saw Hezekiah react. And what's amazing here is in the text, we don't see Hezekiah cry unto God. We don't see him call a prayer meeting. We don't see him do any of those things. Again, what we see is Hezekiah did what many of us do, and that is we react out of fear. But we give the enemy too much credit. Why? Notice here what the text says. The text says, and I don't know about all of the other kingdoms, but the text says that the reason that Israel fell, huh? The reason Israel fell, the text says, is for they refused to listen to the Lord their God and obey him. Instead, they violated his covenant and all the laws that Moses, the Lord's servant, had commanded them to obey. Huh? What the text saying is it's not so much that Sennacherib was the biggest, baddest thing ever. That's not the reason why Israel fell. The reason why Israel fell is because of what the people of God did not do. But Hezekiah looked at that and took the wrong lesson. He took the lesson that, man, this enemy is unconquerable. The reality is there was something else going on. In fact, notice, sometimes it's not that the enemy is unflappable. It is that we have been unfaithful. Huh? Sometimes the enemy is not unflappable. It is that we have been unfaithful. In this situation, it was not that Sennacherib was unconquerable. It is that Israel failed to follow after the Lord. And that's why they fell to the enemy. But Hezekiah didn't check in. Hezekiah just began to react. He began to react immediately. And it brings us to our next point as we move into this narrative. And it's actually in the form of a question. Here it is. Why is it that we negotiate with the enemy instead of wrestling with God? Huh? Why do we negotiate with the enemy instead of wrestling with God? Hezekiah, when he saw what happened to Israel, man, he began to use his tools, use his negotiating tools, leverage his money, leverage other folk money, do everything that his flesh told him to do to try to get out of this situation. He has to negotiate. But one of the things that we have to learn, come on now, is, man, you can't negotiate with the devil. It's not that you and the devil can ever make a deal that he will be satisfied with. Notice what the text says. Verse 16 says, and Hezekiah even stripped the gold from the doorposts of the temple and from the doorposts that he had overlaid with gold, and he gave it to the Assyrian king. Look at verse number 17. I didn't even need to give you the whole text. It says, nevertheless, the king of Assyria sent his commander in chief and his field commander and the chief of his staff from Lachish and a huge army to confront Hezekiah in Jerusalem. Oh, I need you to see this thing. He negotiated with the enemy. He negotiated with Sennacherib. He negotiated with the devil, if you will. Made the best deal that he could find. That deal said, look, man, give me all your money. Give me all the church's money, huh? Strip the house of God bare. And he thought that the enemy would be satisfied. But after Sennacherib got all of that, he then comes back and he does the one thing that Hezekiah didn't want him to do. And that is, he begins his march and he begins his attack on Jerusalem. What we're going to see after this is the utter disrespect that the enemy showed to God and his people. Go with me to verse number 19 through 21. Notice what the Bible says. It says, then the Assyrian king's chief of staff told them to give this message to Hezekiah. He says, this is what the great king of Assyria says. What are you trusting in that makes you so confident? He said, do you think that mere words can substitute for military skill? Who are you counting on that you have rebelled against me? On Egypt? If you lean on Egypt, they will be like a reed that splinters beneath your weight and pierces your hand. Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, is completely unreliable. But perhaps, man, they just talking all kind of stuff. Perhaps you will say to me, we are trusting in the Lord. But isn't he the one who was insulted by Hezekiah? Didn't Hezekiah tear down his shrines and his altars and make everyone in Judah and Jerusalem worship only at the altar that's here in Jerusalem? Notice what we have here. In verse number 23, what we see is just merciless taunting. Just going after, disrespecting, taunting the people of God. What you see next is in verse number 24. They go after him, and he tells them, man, how small your army is. And then in verse number 25, he begins to even lie on God. He say, you relying on God, but God sent us, huh? God sent us to attack you, Hezekiah. Mercy, 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 mercy. But I need you to notice what happens next. In fact, this is a rich story. I beg you to read this after worship, man, just to kind of get the full picture. Verses 26 through 37, what you begin to see is a dangerous level of disrespect. Those verses, what he begins to do is Sennacherib begins to push his chest out, talking about what the God of heaven cannot do. It's a very dangerous thing when you start to talk junk, huh, to the God of heaven, huh? And so in those chapters, in fact, in those verses, read through those when you get to, starting at verse number 26, all kinds of stuff. But notice the heart of it in verse number 33. Here's what Sennacherib and his boys are saying. They say, have any gods of the other nations ever saved their people from the king of Syria? He said, man, why are you fighting, Doc? He said, ain't nobody else's God been able to stand up against us. He says, what happens to the God of Hamath and Arpad? He says, and what about the gods of the Seraphim and Henna and Eva? He said, did any gods rescue Syria from my power? Watch it. He says, what God of any nation has ever been able to save its people from my power? So what makes you think the Lord can rescue Jerusalem from me? Notice, the Bible says, but the people were silent and did not utter a word because Hezekiah had commanded them, do not answer him. He had already insulted them, talked about their army. In fact, we kind of skipped over it, but in their insults, the men of Jerusalem said, man, he said, we understand Aramaic. Don't say it in Hebrew. Say it in Aramaic, because they didn't want to get the people afraid. And the brother begins to give his taunts in Hebrew, scaring everybody. But then his disrespect gets dangerous as Sennacherib and his boys begin to boast. Man, no other God has been able to stand against us. And if no other God can stand against us, then your God ain't going to be able to stand against us either. One of the things we got to understand is at some point, man, this thing is bigger than us, huh? At some point, man, the enemy, when he comes after you, he's really coming after your God, huh? And Sennacherib and his boys begin to show a dangerous level of disrespect. Now, it's one thing to sell wolf tickets, if you will, to taunt Hezekiah and his people, but then he begins to go after the God of heaven. When Hezekiah hears this, he rents his clothes and he begins to send a message to the prophet Isaiah about everything that's going on. And notice what Isaiah sends a word, and notice what he says. Isaiah said to them, say to your masters, thus saith the Lord, do not be afraid because of the words that you have heard, which the servant of the king of Assyria hath reviled me. God said, man, this thing was about me. He says, behold, I will put a spirit in him, so that he shall hear a rumor and return to his own land. And I will make him fall by the sword in his own land. Up until this point, man, it don't look good. City after city in Judah have fallen. There is terrible famine there. If you read closely in the text, some of the stuff that the folk are eating and subsisting on is barely humane. And then he begins to attack the God of heaven. He say, man, ain't no God been able to handle me. And what makes you think that the Lord God of heaven will begin to protect you? And God sends word through Isaiah. I love it. Talking about the disrespect of the enemy. God sends word through Isaiah that watch this, that although nation after nation have fallen, and although the fortified cities of Judah have fallen, he sends word that this brother is going to be taken out by a rumor. So here's what happens. The taunting continues to go back and forth. Messages continue to go back and forth. He's trying to get Hezekiah and him to just give up. And Hezekiah receives another a message from Sennacherib. And it is in the form of a letter. And it is another one of these taunting letters that that speaks against the power of the God of heaven. Oh, notice. Chapter 19, verse 14. Hezekiah receives this message. I love it. It says, and after Hezekiah received the letter from the messengers, he read it and he went up to the temple of the Lord and he spread it out. He spread it out before the Lord. Hezekiah tries a different approach. At first, he tries to use his negotiating skills. And that ends up with no money in the treasury. And he embezzles all of the money in the church, strips the gold off the doorpost, And still the enemy keeps coming. Enemy brings his troops and he begins to taunt him. The same man who paid him everything. You can't negotiate with the devil. He begins to continues to taunt Hezekiah. Finally, Hezekiah does what he should have done at the beginning. And that is he begins the process of taking this thing to the Lord. He sends word to the prophet, and the prophet tells him, look, the Lord said he's going to take this brother down by a rumor. But Sennacherib continues to send those messages of taunts, and he sends him one of those letters. Y'all know them letters you get, the ones that that's bold, that says time sensitive, and you can look through the window, and it's pink. But this letter had bodings of destruction for Judah. Hezekiah does what we've got to learn to do. Come on now. He took the letter. He took the overdue notice. He took the foreclosure notice, and he drops the letter before the altar of the Lord. Can you see it? The last time you got one of those letters, you got one of those bills, and you just spread it before your altar. When was the last time you got some bad news and before you said, man, I'm gonna accept this thing, you spread it out before the Lord. Hezekiah did it like we did it. He tried everything that he knew to try, and yet the enemy kept coming. Finally, he takes that thing to the Lord. In the 2 Kings, the 19th chapter, starting at verse number 19, we see the most beautiful prayer. Bible says, it says in Hezekiah, prayed this prayer. We're just going to share a little bit of it. Hezekiah prayed this prayer before the Lord. He finally took this thing to the Lord. O Lord God of Israel, you are enthroned between the mighty cherub. You alone, God, of all the kingdoms of the earth, you alone created the heavens and the earth. Bend down, O Lord, and listen. Open your eyes, O Lord, and see. Listen to Sennacherib's words of defiance. I'm talking about the disrespect of the enemy. His words of defiance against the living God. It is true, Lord, that the kings of Assyria have destroyed all these nations. He just tells God like it is. And they have thrown down the gods of these nations into the fire and burned them. But of course the Assyrians could destroy them, God, for they are not gods at all. Only the idols of wood and gold shaped by human hands. I love it. Verse 19. Now, O Lord, rescue us from his power, then all the kingdoms of the earth will know that you alone are, O Lord, our God. He finally takes this thing to the Lord. He says, God, you know what's going on. He said, you heard all the mess that Sennacherib is talking. And yeah, he messed up everybody else, but that's because those are not real gods. But notice he enlarged that thing. God, this ain't just about us. It's about you. And God, we are needing you to come to the rescue, huh? Lord, here's the letter. This is what they're saying, God. And this is what they're saying about you. Mercy. And the text, the Bible tells us that God responds, huh? I call this God responds to the shade, if you will. In 2 Kings chapter 19, verses 20 through 34, we begin to hear God's response. God begins to tell Israel what he's going to do for them. God begins to protect. God begins to tell Israel about a future that he has for them. But then God responds to Sennacherib. And I want you to notice what he says. He responds to Sennacherib and he says this. And this is what the Lord says about the king of Assyria. He said, the armies will not enter Jerusalem. They will not shoot an arrow at it. They will not march outside of the gates with their shields, nor build banks of earth against the wall. The king will return to his own country on the same road which he came. He will not enter this city, says the Lord, for my honor, huh? Come on now. For my honor and for the sake of my servant David, I will defend this city and protect it. God said, I don't care what Sennacherib has done. God said, listen, this thing will not stand, huh? Essentially, God says Sennacherib don't have to go home. Come on, somebody. But he gonna have to get up out of here. And I want you to notice, we're not gonna be much longer, but I need you to notice how the Lord responds to his name being defamed, huh? Sennacherib had boasted about his big armies. He had boasted about all of these things, and so all kind of wolf tickets, if you will. Mercy, huh? But God finally stood up, huh? Now I want you to notice something. Earlier in 2 Kings. When Elisha was surrounded by these Assyrian forces, I want you to remember what God did. When Elisha was surrounded by Assyrian forces, if you remember, the servant was saying, man, we in trouble. And God sent a whole host of folk. He sent a whole host of folk. And Elisha, if you remember, he prayed a prayer and he said, Lord, open my servant's eyes that he may see. And the servant's eyes were open, and the conclusion was that they that be with us are more than they that be with them. And I had expected, come on, listen to this. I had expected that when God dealt with Sennacherib and when God dealt with the Assyrian forces, that God would have sent the masses of the armies of the Lord, that God would have sent overwhelming force to take care of them. But that's not what happened in this story, huh? You see, on some level, the disrespect to the God of heaven in this situation was personal. And it is as if God said, you know what? I got this one, huh? Come on now, huh? I got this one, huh? Can you see the angels? The angels saying, Lord, is it time to roll up on the Assyrians? And the Lord say, yeah, it's about time, but I got this one. Lord, how many we bringing? 10,000 times 10,000. How many chariots we're bringing, God? And the Lord says, No. This one right here came up against me. This one disrespected me. I got this one. And notice what the word of God says. The Bible says, and that night, the angel of the Lord, you remember the angel of the Lord, right? The angel of the Lord is the same one who showed up to Abram. The angel of the Lord is the same one who was there in the burning bush. The angel of the Lord, a pre-incarnate Jesus, every now and then, the Lord himself would come down and handle business. And in this situation, God didn't send 10,000 times 10,000. He didn't send the armies like he did in Elijah. It is as if God said, I got this one. And the text says, that night, the angel of the Lord went out to the Assyrian camp and killed 185,000 Assyrian soldiers. When the surviving Assyrians woke up the next morning, they found corpses everywhere. One angel. Huh? Come on now. One angel. Sennacherib boasted about his armies. One angel. He boasted about all of the kingdoms he had taken down. One angel, huh? It is as if God says, I will match your disrespect with disrespect. And I'll match your shade with shade. You talked all kind of mess. Let me show you what the God who you say was not able can do. One angel. 185,000. Oh. And what if Elijah, what if Hezekiah, excuse me, called on the Lord in the very beginning before his money was gone, before temple gold was gone, before his honor was gone, before all of his strength was gone. God say, I got this one. And I need you to know that whatever your problem is, whatever your challenge is, whatever disrespect that the enemy has shown you, every now and then God will stand up and he say, you know what? Let me take. All of this action happened. This response happened when Hezekiah decided to lay the letter. Lay the letter before the Lord. Lay the letter before the Lord. Enemy show, throw shade at Hezekiah. And I don't know about you, but when I saw this, and I saw that after Big Bad Sennacherib had talked about everything he could do, God just sent one. What it said to me was, come on now, I don't know. Maybe I'm not seeing this right. What it said to me was, he said, man, look, I can match the enemy shade for shade, disrespect for disrespect. One. It don't take a lot for God to fight your battle. It don't take a lot for God to conquer your enemies. I want to show you just one more aspect of what I call a disrespect of the enemy. When we were kids, there was a there was one kind of disrespect that you could show when you were in a fight. Huh? See, when a fight was about to break out, when a fight was about to start, and you did all this kind of preparing, and you chopped around, and you tried to protect. That was the. But one of the things that you could do that showed your enemy that you have a total lack of respect and regard for their ability is when in the run-up to the fight, when you just looked at the enemy, you say, man, just take your shot. When you went up to the enemy and you gave him that chin and you said, take your best shot. That showed the enemy that you didn't respect. And when you just said, man, take your best shot. All of these years, the devil has shown God's people every bit of disrespect. Huh? All of these years, the enemy has shown a total lack of regard for God's people. But as I looked at the cross, come on, somebody. As I looked at the cross and I saw how that thing unfolded, man, something hit me that never hit me before like this. You see, essentially what God does with Satan at the cross, he doesn't send armies to defeat him. He didn't do that. What God did to the enemy, huh? Is he say, devil, hit me with your best shot. Come on now. It is amazing to me that Jesus defeats Satan, not in a battle. Come on now. He defeats Satan by dying. Come on, think about that. Jesus defeated Satan by approaching Satan and essentially, give me your best shot. He tells him, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men to me. What he essentially does is what the boys used to do on the playground. He simply went up to Satan and he, come on. Ultimate disrespect. He said, nobody can take my life. I give it. Say, devil, I will allow you to hit me with your best shot. But what you don't know, come on now, is if you hit me, you lift me. Mercy. As we're closing, what I need you to understand is that I don't care how rough and tumble your enemy acts. I don't care how scary the prognosis or the diagnosis. The thing that we have learned today is number one, we've got to be prayed up. Why? Because when crises hit, you don't know what you might do. And if by chance you begin to react before you reach out to God, who knows what you may get yourself into. God didn't realize, man, this thing was not about how bad Sennacherib was. This thing was about God. Finally, he presents the letter to the Lord. He lays it before the altar. God matches the enemy shade for shade, disrespect for disrespect. One angel. That one angel and a rumor Text says after Sennacherib's army wiped out, he goes back home to Assyria while his folk worshiping. There's a rumor that he heard. Goes back home and he is assassinated by his own big, bad Sennacherib. Conquered all of the kingdoms around. Had folk in utter terror. Conquered by one angel and a rumor. What can stand before our God? Not any problem, not any difficulty. Nothing if we give it to the Lord. And what I saw in this text is that the Lord sometimes will take out the enemy with a little bit of flair. Come on, somebody. One angel, huh? And a rumor. The cross. Lift me. You hit me, you're going to lift me. Just want to encourage you as we close that no matter what the enemy is, quickly make your way into the presence of God. Before we close, there may be somebody who needs this kind of God on your side. Not just in an emergency. Every day. God of heaven will stand by you. God of heaven will be your constant companion. Not only fight with you, but will fight. Doors of the church are open. Anybody, the Spirit of God has been speaking to you. He's saying, man, you can't do this thing without me. You can't do it without me. If you could, you would have conquered it all. Enemy has left you destitute. He's left you depleted. He's left you depressed. Won't you bring it and yourself to me? Spirit of God is impressing you to make that decision for him. Let us know about it. Send us a text. Let us know the decision that you've made. Give Jesus Christ your heart and let him fight with you every battle. Let him match your enemy shade for shade, disrespect for disrespect. Heavenly Father God, we thank you for being with us today. We thank you for the word of God. I thank you, God, that Lord God, that when the enemy comes in like a flood, Lord, that you lift up a standard against him. God bless the decisions that have been made for you today. But help us, Lord God, to take everything to you. There's nothing too big for you. Thank you, God, and we bless your name for being with us today. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you.
It's a pleasure to meet you. Such a blessing to greet you. Have Gloria. We're happy to see you. It's a pleasure to meet you. Such a blessing to greet you at Berean.
We're happy to see you.
It's a pleasure to meet you. Just a blessing to greet you at Berean. We're happy to see you. It's a pleasure to meet you. Such a blessing to greet you at Berean. We're happy to see you. It's a pleasure to meet you, just a blessing to greet you, I'm Gloria.
Come on, everybody.